Hey, it's so great to be here. How you doing today? Great. Yeah, we had so much fun last night. Ladies, thanks for showing up. God showed up, you showed up. It was awesome, right? Hey, I want to just give honor really quickly. I love your church. This is my first time here. First time, actually, to Springfield, Missouri. And I feel like I've gotten the VIP treatment because you've been so welcoming and kind. And your church, I love what God is doing here. I love worshiping with you. Your pastors, Pastor Peter and Nadia, they are the real deal. Getting to know them has been such a place of refreshing for me, and it's been so encouraging to me. They're the kind of people that, man, they love people. They're for people. They're for you. You start talking to them afterwards, you feel better about life. You feel encouraged. Those are the kind of people to be around, and those are certainly the kind of people we want to see pastored and caring and leading church. And actually, the whole team is an expression of that. So I want to give honor to your pastors, but I also want to give honor to the team. And by team, I mean anybody who actually serves of their time or their talent here, because this isn't built on one person. This is actually built on a company of people who say, God's called me to do something, and I want to use my gifts, and I want to use my time for the greater good. And without them serving from the parking lot to coffee to the Connect Center to kids ministry to right here on the stage using their musician gifts and musician gifts. You can tell I'm a very musical person myself. Without them actually serving and using what they have, we wouldn't be here today being able to have the experience that we're having and be on the receiving end of other people's obedience. It's because people serve faithfully that we get to be in an atmosphere where we get to be encouraged in our faith. We get to connect with the presence of God and grow community together. So thank you. If you serve in any capacity, I want to say thank you. Thank you for what you do here. We are so grateful for you. And I'm really excited this morning because I believe God has something so unique to say to every single one of us. You know, this is what I love about God. He can take one message and he can make it so personal and relevant to every single one of us. That's only by the power of God, by the grace of his presence at work in our lives. And have you ever had the experience where you've left a church service or you've heard something and go, I feel like that was just for me. I feel like that person was speaking just to me. I don't really believe that that's the eloquence of somebody's words. I believe that is the power of the Holy Spirit. And I believe that God wants to do that today for every single one of us, regardless of where we are in our journey of faith. He has something real for us to grab a hold of today. So why don't we pray and lean into what God has? Jesus, we thank you that you're here. We thank you for your presence. We thank you where your presence is. There's freedom. There's hope. There's life. There's new beginnings. There's strength. There's courage. We need it, God. We need you. And so I pray that you'd speak to us in such a personal way. Speak to the places that we don't even know need to be spoken to. And I pray that as we open our hearts to you, that you would be so good to us, God, that we would have an experience with you. Not just talking about you. That's, I guess, the danger of church is we can come together and talk a lot about you and not experience you. But we want to experience your presence today. Because Jesus, you are the one who transforms us. You are the one who changes us. You're the one who gives us hope and life, eternal life. And so God, we look to you this morning. And I pray that we would leave here different because we've had an encounter that is so real with your presence, with your living word, with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so we're new friends. We're still getting to know each other. So here's a little interesting fact about me. I am not what you would call the most athletic person. Now, I know you're shocked. You look at me and you think Olympian. I know. And it's not that I don't have a competitive spirit. I'm fiercely competitive. It's that, sadly, I'm not the most coordinated human being. You know, so I've got heart for days. I'm all in it. But usually my enthusiasm doesn't actually match my skill set, you know, and that's always been the case ever since I was a little kid. And I remember in PE class and in gym class where there would be sports games that we'd play and you'd split up into two teams and there was always student team captains, right, that were assigned. And then they would start to pick who they wanted on their team. Well, I was never picked first. I was never picked second, but don't feel sorry for me because I was self-aware. Even as a kid, I knew what to root for and hope for. And so I never dreamed of being first pick. I just didn't want to be last pick, okay? I did everything I could to stay out of that zone. And because I had some good, emotional IQ and social awareness, and I was a motivated team player, I never actually was last pick. But I'll tell you, there were a few times that it was close. Those are scary moments, okay? Because when you're standing there and you're surrounded by your peers and students and the pool around you is getting smaller and smaller, you're beginning to sweat because nobody wants to be picked last for a team, right? It's basically the team captain publicly acknowledging that they see zero potential for what you can bring to the team, right? They're not picking you because they want you on the team. They're picking you because they're forced to. I remember in middle school, I actually decided to join my school's field and track team. Now, I didn't do it because I had a natural knack for running, because I enjoyed running, because I wanted to aspire to some sort of like Olympic feat. I did it because all my friends were doing it and I give in easy to peer pressure, at least I did back then. And I got assigned to long distance running. Whew. The torturous things you do to fit in as a teenager, okay? And I remember as I started to train, as we started to have practices and go to meets and all of that, because I had never been a first pick, I never imagined that I could actually place first in a race. That seemed way beyond my reach. History had taught me very different from that reality. So instead, once again, I just aspired to be out of the last place, last picked zone of life. So with every race, with every practice, with every meet, I aspired to not first place, not second place, but third. Because third still places. Third is like you deliver the bronze medal, so to speak, for your team. And more importantly, you are not last place. And can I tell you, for every race, every meet of my short-lived field and track career, what I placed, third. Exactly, and not a bit more than what I believed I was capable of. But you know, I look back on that experience that I had as a kid, and I don't think it's an isolated one. I think most of us can understand this, because most of us aren't first picks. And most of us didn't have the experience of somebody saying, you are voted most likely to succeed. We weren't graduating valedictorian of our class. We didn't land the dream job on the first interview. Many of us, we didn't get the affection or the attention in our home growing up that we had hoped for. We didn't have the experience of somebody that we admired pointing us out at a young age and saying, you kid, you right there, you've got some potential. And when life repeatedly sends the subliminal message that we aren't first picks, then after a while, we subtly stop aspiring to first place. Instead, we'll kind of settle for somewhere in the middle, like third, because we don't want to be last place. We don't want last place lives. But not everybody can be the Beyoncés and Steve Jobs of the world, okay? So not everybody can live extraordinary lives. So we'll just kind of settle for somewhere in the middle, you know? We'll be decent people. We'll try to make good choices, and we'll be responsible, and we'll pay our bills on time. And if we have any extra time, we'll serve in the community, and we'll avoid illegal activity and drama, you know? Good people. It's not amazing, but it's something. And okay. We're right to think that, because our world definitely could use some more decency and good behavior and less illegal activity and more nice people, especially standing in long lines at the grocery store, right? But go with me for a second. Like, what if this train of thinking is entirely wrong? Like, what if we have been picked? What if we are chosen? What if we have been called to greatness, but we just fail to hear the call? I mean, what a tragedy our lives would be if we were first picks, capable of living first place lives, but because we didn't know it, we never lived out the lives that we could, living the full potential that was within us. In Jesus' time, there was a group of men that were living under this horribly inaccurate assumption that they weren't first picks. They're fishermen. Now, it was not glamorous work, nothing really glorious about it, manual labor, routine, kind of smells, right? But it brought home money, you know, and it was the family trade. It was what your dad did, it was what his dad did, it was his dad did, you know, it was what was expected of you. Now, of course, if you wanted to, you could pivot and create a different career path for yourself, but if you were a conquered people living under the great Roman Empire, which these Jewish fishermen were, you didn't do that. You just put down your head, you did your work, you didn't make waves. The only exception would be that if at a young age you showed a superior aptitude to understanding the things of God, if you demonstrated some sort of great potential to understand scripture and understand the ways of God and to show some ability to perhaps even teach people the ways of God, then in the Jewish community at the time, as a young person, as a teenager, you were handpicked from the group by the local rabbis and religious scholars, and you were chosen to be trained to be a disciple and become a rabbi yourself or a religious scholar yourself. the most prestigious role, by the way, at that time in the Jewish community. But these guys, their time came to be picked, and no one did. And so they just went about their ordinary lives. They made the most of their situation. They went to the family trade, and day in and day out, that's what they did. Meanwhile, greatness lay dormant within them. They were capable of extraordinary, but because nobody ever called it out from within them, they continued to live ordinary lives until one day when Jesus shows up in the midst of their fishing, and he interrupts their fishing and, well, everything else. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 18, here's where their story begins. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. Many translations say, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. They left the boat and their father and followed him. Now think about this. Jesus, God in human form, Savior of the world, everlasting light, who descended from heaven to dispel the powers of darkness here on earth. The one who paid the ultimate price on the cross for humanity's destruction, who conquered death himself, the resurrected one, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the Lord Almighty, the King of Kings, the Rabbi of all rabbis, shows up and invites these guys to join the team of greatness. They had to have been bewildered, shocked, stunned, surprised, amazed. Have you ever had that moment when you're like standing in a parking lot or a large room and somebody waves at you, and so you wave back and suddenly you realize they weren't waving at you, the person behind you, just a few, that's an awkward moment, right? You're like, try to recover, right? I imagine these guys having this moment where they just wanted to make sure this was really for them, you know? Me? And even though they had no idea just how radically their lives would change by saying yes to this invitation, and how radically they would shape not just history, but eternity, they did the only thing that makes sense when the greatest one of all calls you to greatness. You drop everything and you join the team. And maybe, just maybe, that's why many of us still hold on to things that we know we should be dropping, because we're still waiting for our moment with Jesus by the sea. Certain things. Our ego and our pride and our fears and our insecurities and our shame and our secrets and our compromises, because these are the things that we've needed to make most sense of our world. Like, this is the things that we've created our life to make the most of what's been handed to us. And we're gonna keep holding on to these things until we have a good enough reason to drop them. We'll keep holding on to these things, failing to recognize that the very things that have got us placing third place lives are the things that are keeping us from first place living. But one moment with Jesus, come on, one moment with Jesus, and everything can change. Okay, some of you are going, all right, girl, you need to calm down a little bit. You're getting very excited in this room. Reality check. This isn't over 2,000 years ago. We are not by the Sea of Galilee. Jesus is not approaching us in the flesh, walking towards us. Yeah, you're right. But what if Jesus is still calling? What if he's still in the business of calling? And what if he's calling you right where you are, in your city, in your neighborhood, in your community, in your family, in your workplace, in your gym? And what if he's calling you now? Not tomorrow, Not someday when you're adulting better and making more responsible decisions, or you figured out a few things, or you have more margin in your life to give back, or you've suddenly learned how to appear holy and righteous and say all the wonderful Christian things you're supposed to in a church service. When somebody asks you how your day's going, God bless you, hallelujah, praise him, amen. You know, what if, before you figured out all that, what if Jesus is calling you today? And what if heaven was singling you out for greatness? What if God had destined you to live an extraordinary life? What if he's calling you to that right now, and you knew by responding to that call, by saying yes, it would change everything in your life? What would you be willing to do? What would you be willing to drop to respond to heaven's call to greatness? Everything? Yeah, me too. Well, I have good news. Jesus is calling. He's calling every single one of us here in this room today to follow him more closely than ever before, to become people we didn't even know we were capable of becoming, to make an impact in this world beyond our wildest dreams. I'm about to read words that Jesus spoke to his disciples over 2,000 years ago. And these words, I believe, are just as relevant and powerful as the day that they were first spoken. In fact, I believe that they were intentionally recorded in Scripture for us here in this moment to hear and respond to. These are Jesus's words to us in John chapter 15. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. In other words, we've been picked. We've been chosen, and we're not last picks either. Whew. And we're not fourth place or third picks or second picks. We've been first pick chosen. And some of us really need to hear this here today, because some of us are at a place in our life where we're trying to make sense of our situation. We're trying to make sense of our season. We're wrestling, we're struggling, we're trying to go, what am I even here to do? What's the purpose of this season? Why am I here? What is happening? What is the difference? And we're assessing between what is religion and what is really Jesus, and what is tradition and what is something that's real. And we're trying to sort it out. We're trying to make sense of ourselves, of life, of our season, of circumstances, of faith. And we find ourselves inching towards God. Some of you are here today because you're inching towards God. You're trying to make sense of something. But friends, what you have to realize is way before you are inching your way to God, God was running to you. You have been made with purpose. You have been formed with destiny in your veins. You have been plucked out of eternity and placed here and now for such a time as this. You are not an accident. You are not a failure. You are not a mistake. You are not second rate. You are not mediocre. You are not second pick. You are first pick chosen. And when you get an understanding of that, when we get a revelation of just how chosen by God we are, it's like the places that were dark and confusing and frustrating are all of a sudden illuminated by the power of God in our lives. We are chosen. Chosen. And Jesus here, when he says the word chosen in the Greek, it could be translated to also say elected. And so we're chosen, we're elected, and appointed. And the Greek word that's used here could also be translated to say set in a specific position. So think about this. Nothing of what Jesus says here, do something to earn our place on the team. We don't hustle to make the cut. We don't prove ourselves by somehow in order to be used by God. None of that qualifies us. The thing that qualifies us to live extraordinary lives is simply that Jesus has chosen us. He qualifies us. It's as if Jesus is saying, there's nothing you can do to make sense of your life on your own. There's nothing you can do to live the extraordinary life that I've called you to. You've just got to let my grace in and let my grace make a way for your life to be great. The implication of this is extraordinary, because it means we don't have to figure things out before we fully follow Jesus. We don't have to have it all together and say all the right things and know all the right answers and quote all the right verses. We don't have to attend church a certain number of times, like check, 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 now we can be used by God. No, no, no. It means we can embrace everything that God has for us now. May I suggest that if we're waiting to have our lives fully together before we fully follow Jesus, then we are simply wasting valuable time. Life is far too short to be living third place lives when we were capable of first place living. We're chosen. We're chosen to bear fruit. Now, the fruit that Jesus speaks of in this world, or speaks of here in this verse, is not fruit of this world. It's not accruing a ton of money or fame or wealth or power or attaining a to-be-envied career or an always selfie-ready life or a picture-perfect relationship. I will admit, at times, these things sound very enticing. Have you ever had a moment in your day where you're like, I'm pretty sure a celebrity's not dealing with this, right? Okay, I get it. But those things, they lack any real substance. Those things can never fully satisfy the deep longing within each of us to live significant lives. No, the fruit that Jesus speaks of here is fruit not of this world. It's the fruit of the work of the Spirit of God in our lives. It's seen in the way that we're able to embody love and truth on a daily basis. It's seen in the way that we're able to respond with the kindness of God in the midst of brokenness. It's seen in the way that we bring light to the places that are dark in our world. It's seen actually in the lives of other people who are experiencing the goodness of God because we chose a life of mission over mediocrity. Go and bear fruit. Go and bear fruit. Implying that if we're going to live chosen, then it means it changes what we do. If we're going to embrace a life of being chosen by God, then it's going to require action. Movement requires action, right? This idea of moving forward towards the things of God, mission requires this action in our lives. In fact, Jesus emphasizes this very thing in Matthew 28 with the Great Commission. He says, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go. Go and bear fruit. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Go and make disciples. Go. Listen, what's happening here is pretty extraordinary. What God is doing in this environment, come on, the way that we're getting to experience the presence of God and healing and hope and new beginnings and love and strength and courage, the way that we're experiencing God radically and deeply at work in our lives through what's happening right here, the way that we get to experience authentic Christ-centered community, this is amazing, but what is happening here cannot stay here. It cannot be contained to these walls. We're called to go. Go into our workplaces. Go into the gym. Go into our neighborhoods. Go into our families. Go into the city itself. Go and spread the good news of Jesus Christ. Go and let people others know the story of redemption that God has done for you. Go. Go and be a light and serve. Go and make a difference. Go and not only tell people about Jesus, but actually help them daily know what it means to follow him. Go. Go and bear fruit that lasts. Here's a sobering thought. Despite what we've been told by our modern evangelical world, this is not simply the mandate or the mission of just the pastors and the teachers and the evangelists and the preachers. We've all been called to go and bear fruit that lasts. And me, right here with this mic, preaching this message, and going and traveling and preaching Jesus and what I do with writing and encouraging and serving in my church and as a pastor, all of these things, I still cannot reach people for Jesus the way that you can. I can't lead your coworker to Jesus the way that you can. I can't bring healing to your family the way that your faith can. I can't revitalize Springfield with the gospel message of Jesus Christ the way that this church community can. That's you. So you got to do you, boo. Because if you don't, who will? If you don't love that coworker or that friend or that cousin who's going through a lot right now, whose hot mess moment is happening right now, who's dealing with a lot of dysfunction or disappointment or frustration or heartbreaking situations, if you don't love them and serve them and show up for them and pray for them and invite them and be there for them when they need them, who will? That's you. We've been called to go. Go and bear fruit that lasts. This is what it means to be chosen. That's going to look different for every single one of us. We're going to contextualize it to our opportunities, our relationships, our experiences, our own story of what God's done in our life, our own talents and gifts and abilities. And yet, To live chosen, there's a few things that are pretty common about that. And with the time that we have here this morning, I want to quickly explore a couple of those things. What does it mean to actually live chosen? It's one thing to say yes to living chosen in an environment like this, but what does it mean tomorrow and the day after that and the day after that? There's a lot of qualities that we could talk about that's common for every single one of us. But firstly, it's worth pointing out this, that Christ has chosen us to not just consume, but to contribute. He's called us to contribute, which is a little counterculture to the world we live in today because we live in a consumer-driven society, right? We do. And it's not all bad. I mean, it's fueled, you know, a lot of advancement in technology and certainly opportunities for people. There's been, a number of people that have made it big over a really good idea for a product, right? But there is a dark side to consumerism. It breeds selfishness and greed and corruption and injustice. And if we're not careful, we'll let a spirit of consumerism seep into our spirituality. What will happen is it'll downgrade our faith to merely a product. It will dumb down our church services to merely entertainment. It will degrade a relationship with God to turn into something that's merely transactional. Don't get me wrong, in one sense, following Jesus means that we're signing up to be consumers. Because every day we get to be on the receiving end of God's goodness. Every morning we get to consume of his mercies that are new for us every day. Every morning we get to receive our daily bread. Every morning we get to experience the forgiveness and the grace of God that is sufficient for us. Every morning we get to live in this reality that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. In one sense, every single day we are on the consuming end if we're truly following Jesus of his love, his goodness, his power at work in our lives. And yet, the call is not simply to consume of Jesus and hoard it, but to give it away freely. To be not a reservoir, so to speak, of the good things that God is doing in our lives, but to be streams of living water to those around us. We see this so perfectly illustrated in an interaction that Jesus has with his disciples in Matthew chapter 14. Jesus is ministering to multitudes, thousands of people, and he's sharing the good news. And it's getting late, and people are hungry, and the disciples are hungry. So the disciples approach Jesus, and they say, send the people home, because it's getting late, and they need to eat. But Jesus has a different idea. Jesus is reminding them in this moment that the call is not just to consume, but there's opportunity always to contribute. And here is how the miracle that's about to happen unfolds. Jesus replies to them, they don't need to go away. The crowd doesn't need to get sent home. You give them something to eat. He says to the disciples, you give them something to eat. We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. Bring them here to me, he said. And Jesus directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and he broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men besides women and children. Jesus says, you give them something to eat. They didn't think they had anything to contribute. But the moment they brought what they could to Jesus, even though it seemed little, even though it seemed insignificant, even though it seemed like a drop of water in an ocean, right? When they understood that they've been chosen not just to stand back and watch, but they've been chosen to contribute, the moment they brought their little to Jesus, that was the catalyst for the miracle. That's when the miracle began. And this was a miracle that didn't just feed a few, it fed the multitudes. Friends, your little time, your little energy, your little resource, your little talent, your little part of your day that you make room for others, those little things, when we submit them and surrender them to the masterful hand of Jesus, that's where miracles begin, not just for a few, but many, not just for one, but a community, not just for a handful, but for a city. It begins when we realize we have something to contribute. And friends, we need to get this revelation because our world is hungry for salvation. I don't know if we've realized this, and I don't want to be a Debbie Downer here, but can we take a moment to realize our world is in need? Like you look at the news feed, and what do you see? Brokenness. And you look at social media. Just look at a comment section of any article, and believe me, you'll be reminded brokenness, right? But we don't even need to go to social media or the internet or TV. Come on, it's in our workplaces. It's in our streets. It's in our neighborhoods. It's in our schools. It's in our families. Some of us right now here today, we're in a season of brokenness ourselves. Things are difficult. Things are challenging. We know what it means to be in need. And we simply cannot allow a consumerism faith to keep us from bringing the hope of Jesus to a world that's desperately hungry and searching. It's kind of like the movie Titanic. Okay, go with me for a second, all right? Some of you remember this movie. It came out about 20 years ago. It was starring a young Leonardo DiCaprio and Kate Winslet, aka Jack and Rose. And it was this classic love story told so many different ways, so many times, right? It's a story of a rich girl meets poor boy. They fall in love only to have a really bad encounter with an iceberg on a cruise ship, and then disaster strikes, right? We hear it all the time. I remember when this movie came out, and I'm dating myself, I'm aging myself, but it came out when I was in middle school. And I remember seeing it with my girlfriends, not once, not twice, but like three or four times in a row, because it was the obsession of every teenage girl when it came out. This was before the days of Netflix and even having easy access to seeing movies on repeat right away. And so girls were going to the same movie theater again and again to watch this. And they were sitting in the movie theater, and my friends, they were like weeping watching this. They were like, someday I will have my Jack. He will come rescue me like this is happening to Kate Winslet right now. Someday I will meet my Leo. Like, it was a thing. It was very bizarre. And so many different scenes from this movie became iconic, and we remember them. Even today, some of us who've lived through that era, we can think of certain scenes from this movie Titanic. Well, there's one scene towards the end of the film, and a spoiler alert, in case you didn't realize the plot of Titanic, they hit an iceberg and it sinks. And so they're now, everybody who's on the ship, including Jack and Rose, they're trying to live through this experience. And so as they find themselves jumping from the ship that's sinking, they're falling into freezing cold water that will kill them within minutes. And so everybody's looking for some objects and debris that are floating around this disaster so that they can get out of the cold water and wait for the rescue boats that are coming. It's the only way that they can survive. And so Jack, he's the hero, and he safely leads Rose through the freezing cold waters, and he sees this big, I'll emphasize big, massive wooden door, and he gets his young love, Rose, on the door safely out of the water, and then he attempts to join her once, I'll emphasize only once, and then when that doesn't work, he just stays in the water, and he holds her hand, and he begins to remind her of the extraordinary long life that she's going to live and keep her having hope until the rescue boats can arrive. And this clip we're about to watch, it reveals the fate of Jack and Rose. Let's take a look right now.
Jack. There's a boy. Jack.
So romantic. Okay, so I hate to be the romantic cynic in the room, or perhaps the voice of reason, but seriously, it didn't have to go down that way. Like, I don't know if you could see how big that wooden door was, but they both could have fit. Rose, you killed your boo, okay? I'll never let go. We watched you let go. Like, right now, we watched you do it, you know? She killed Leo. Like, that's horrible. Worse, she killed young Leo, okay? That is awful, right? Rose, you are the worst. And sometimes I think about this scene and it gets me angry all over again because I'm like, really? This is the worst ending. They could have both lived. It could have been different. But also because I feel like this is a bit of a haunting reminder of, if we're not careful, what the church could become in this generation. Because here we are, and like Rose, we have been rescued from the freezing cold waters. But our freezing cold waters are of death and destruction and sin and shame and fear. And here we are experiencing salvation. And yet all around us are people who are desperately searching for salvation, searching for hope. And instead of actually making room for them to experience the love of God, instead, we're just issuing out really, really empty words like, I'll never let you go. But instead for us as the church, it's, oh, God bless you. Oh, bless your heart. Oh, I'll be praying for you. You know what? I'll make a hashtag and put up something on social media to let you know I'm thinking about you. Come on, friends. That cannot be the legacy that we leave as the church today. There is work to be done. There's a world that needs to know, hey, there's a place for you here. There's a place for you to experience the love of God, to encounter God's presence, to encounter God's power, not to encounter religion, not to encounter culturally what is the norm, but to actually have a revival type experience with the kingdom of God, with Jesus Christ at work in your life. Friends, let's be the kind of people that are always looking out into the waters, always looking around us and saying, come on, there's room for you. There's room for you. I want to be a rescuer of hope in the mighty name of Jesus. I want people to experience the goodness of God because I saw and made room. And friends, while we're on the subject, let's make room for whoever God wants on the door. Let's not be selective about who we'll make room for. Let's make room for the people that don't look like us or think like us or vote like us or have the same backgrounds or experiences. Let's not decide who gets to receive the salvation that we've received. Instead, let's just make room. Let's make our life about contributing and seeing people encounter the love of God right around us. We've been called. We've been chosen to contribute, not just consume. So what does this look like practically for us? Very quickly, I mean, how do we leave here and not just say yes to living chosen, but what does that look like tomorrow? How do we contribute every day? Well, I think there's a couple things that we can keep in mind as we step away from this message. You know, Jesus, when he called the disciples, he said, I'm calling you. And guess what? If you say yes, I'll make you fishers of men. This was a clear metaphor. It was brilliant because he was saying, listen, your life used to be about fishing, but now it's going to be about people. It used to be about the what of your life, the career, the path, the accomplishments, the success, the things you achieve. But now it's going to be about the people that I've called you to reach. Once upon a time, it used to be more about the what, but now it's going to always be more about the who. And friends, for us to live called and chosen and to embrace this, it means that we prioritize in our life the who over the what. It means that when we go to work tomorrow, we look up and we look around and we pay attention. And we invite God to lead us to those conversations, to those moments, to those invitations, to be a listening ear, to pray, to hope, to serve the people around us. It's always going to be for us, who has God called us to? It's always going to require us, living chosen, to lift up our head and look around. Not just see our own needs, but to see the needs of those around us and to respond in those moments with the life-giving message of Jesus, with the love and character of Jesus and the way that we serve people and see people. And friends, here's a little secret. When we make the priority of who more than the what in our life, if we focus on the who that God's called us to right in front of us, then the what of our life becomes clear along the way. So often we're looking, what, God, what am I supposed to do? And he's saying, just focus on who's around you and serve them. And I promise you, I'll make the what clear. And secondly, it means that we just make the most of the opportunities to do good that are in front of us. We just seize the opportunities as they come. You know, so often we kind of excuse ourselves from doing things because we think, I don't have enough, you know? If I had more time, well, then I would serve more. If I had more money, then I'd give more. If I had a different background or experience, well, then I'd have more to say. If I had a different work environment or school environment, then of course I'd share my faith more. And the list could go on and on and on. We tend to overestimate the power of what we don't have, and we underestimate the power of what we actually do have. And I understand that for many of us in this room, probably all of us, there's some area of our life that's less than ideal, okay? And yet, what would happen If we left here and we began to see not what we don't have, but we began to focus on what we do have, the opportunities right in front of us, they appear every single day to do good right where we are. Sometimes we overcomplicate what actually following Jesus on a day-to-day basis looks like, what it means to live with purpose and destiny in our veins. It's not complicated, it's simple. We just seize good as it comes along. We see opportunities and we make the most of them. That is what it looks like to live chosen in our world today. I want to invite the team to come up. We're going to worship God together in just a moment. Friends, I hope you leave here today, and I hope you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you've been chosen, that God has picked you. You're his first pick, that he has such extraordinary things to do through you, that he's called you for this time in this city right where you are, and that you can be the catalyst of good right where you are, that because you say yes, people can have a different eternity, have a different outcome, have a different experience, can experience the goodness of God. I pray you walk away with your head held high, knowing that heaven has called you, knowing that your life is significant, and knowing that there's something you can do every day to live chosen. I pray that we'd be the kind of people who are willing to drop whatever we need to drop in order to fully embrace a life of being chosen. And I also believe that there's people in this room who, in all honesty, you're here today and you just feel far from God. You know, you're hearing this message, and maybe at one point you had a very real personal relationship with Jesus, but that's not where you feel today. That's not where you're at. Life happened, things happened, and here you are. Or maybe you're in this room, and in all honesty, you've actually never made faith personal. Like, maybe you've grown up in church, maybe you've been to church, you know the thing, you know the deal. Maybe you check the box Christian. Said, you know, I don't want to just be like culturally Christian. I don't just want to be a sometimes church goer. I don't just want to associate with, you know, the right language to say in certain environments, but I want something that's real and personal. I want to know Jesus in a real way. I want to experience his love. I want to know what it means to just fully daily follow him and experience his plans for my life. I want to go from this thing that seems kind of distant to something that's personal and real. Well, today, friends, you can begin that journey of following Jesus in a personal way. You can make it a decision. You're not embracing religion, you're embracing a relationship with Jesus that's real and authentic and life-changing. He has that for you today, either for the first time, for those of you who've never made that decision, or if you're in this room and at one point you had, but you feel far today from God, you can come right back to that place where it becomes personal again, and you can experience his goodness, his salvation, the plans that he has for your life. And here's the great news. All we need to do to actually receive this, to walk out this, to make it personal, simply ask, just ask God to acknowledge our need for a Savior and to discover his plans for our life in the process. So here's what I want us to do. I don't want anybody looking around, but I do want to know who I'm about to pray for. If that's you in this room, you say, yeah, that's me. That's where I'm at today. I feel far from God and I want to get my heart right. I want to have a personal faith in Jesus today. I want to leave here having that. Then I just want you to acknowledge that that's you in this room by waving at me. Can you just wave at me so I can know who I'm about to pray for in this room? And I see a couple hands going up here, but nobody's looking around. But I just, you're saying, I'm acknowledging my need for a Savior like this. I'm acknowledging my need for something that's personal and real. I see that hand. Is there anybody else? 1, 2, 3. Go ahead and just wave your hand at me if there's anybody else in this room. That's brilliant. Okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray together very quickly. And those of you who did raise your hand, I hope I saw it. If I didn't, heaven does. But here's what we're going to do. We're all going to pray together very quickly. And so I want you just to repeat after me, everybody in this room, as a show of support for those who in this moment are choosing to make their faith personal and real. They're choosing to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. Come on, let's support everybody. And everybody join me in this prayer. Say, Jesus, I thank you that you've chosen me. Thank you that you gave your life for me. That you died for me on the cross, that you rose from the dead, that you love me, and that you have a great plan for my life. And so from this day forward, I'm placing my faith in you. I'm making it personal. I'm acknowledging my need for you, Jesus. I pray you would lead and guide my life. I accept the gift of salvation you have for me. And from this day forward, I'm a follower of you. Lead and guide me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, can we give a huge round of applause to those who made that decision here? There's no greater decision than the one that you just made. Listen.